गुरुर् ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। So last week towards the end, before we begin, we are in Keno Upanishad chapter 2, verse number 4, the verse on Pratibodha Viditam Matam. Pratibodha Viditam Matam Amritatvam Hi Vindate Atmana Vindate Viryam Vidyaya Vindate Amritam. And last week, we're looking at the Baudha Paksha, and the Baudha Paksha, what does it say? The nihilist philosophy, it says when the object and the mind come together, then and then alone the consciousness, the spark of consciousness is created. So if we take that argument, then conscious gets created, consciousness gets destroyed. Again, next time, next object the mind gets in touch, contact with, again the consciousness is created, again it is destroyed. This is unacceptable to us, and that Atma is destroyed every moment. So we cannot accept their interpretation of the Atman, of the consciousness. What they are talking about is the kshanik vidya, that and the kshanik, that which comes and goes every moment. You remember, aham also comes and goes with every thought. If you have known aham idam, the seer, seen and seeing. So the seer is born with the seen. Are we talking about the consciousness, that which comes and goes with every thought, just like the eye comes and goes with every thought? Or are we talking about the consciousness which is ever, which is the constant, which never has gone away, which is continuous without a break? Isn't that our experience of ourselves, that we are continuous without a break? When we say something has come and gone, we say a thought has come and gone, the emotion has come and gone, the waker, dreamer, sleeper have come and gone, the day has come and gone, the childhood, youth, teenage has come and gone. It's always with reference to something. And with that something, the teenager was with the teenage body, the child was with the child body. We are not talking about that child consciousness. We are not talking about that teenage consciousness. We are not talking about that youth consciousness. We are not talking about the waker consciousness. We are not talking about the dream consciousness or the sleep consciousness. Neither are we talking about the seer consciousness, hearer consciousness, taster consciousness, etc. Or the thinking consciousness, feeling consciousness. No. All these fellows come and go. Do you feel you are coming and going with every one of those coming and going? No, that's not your experience. That's not our experience. So Vedanta is very clear. Pratibodha viditam matam does not mean that that consciousness, that reflected consciousness, which is as if coming and going, but it is the constant one, because that is our direct experience. That is our aprokshanubhuti. Because so many thoughts have come and gone through your mind in last 2-3 minutes. Have you come and gone? No. You are still there. Catch that one. Then we truly understand the pratibodhamatam. But with this kshanik vidya, temporary expression of consciousness as I, which comes with every object, with every experience, with every contact, with every thought, we are not talking about that consciousness. And then we got into this topic, Yat Punaha, page 80 in the Shankar Bhashya, Yat Punaha Pratibodha Shabdena Nirnimittaha Bodaha Pratibodaha Yatha Suptasya Iti Artaha Parikalpayanti Sakrut Vignanam Pratibodha Iti Apare Nirnimittaha Sanimittaha Sakrudva Pratibodha Evahi Saha. So in short, what does it say? That Pratibodha is this causeless knowledge. Our nature, which is the Pratibodha. Pratibodha is knowledge of the self. Where is our knowledge normally? We have already refuted that. One argument came before that it is at the intellect level. We said no. At intellect level only the thought comes and goes. Excuse me. So is this nirnimitta jnana? Nirnimitta means without reference, without any support, without any nimitta, without any cause, without any purpose. See, that we are, that is our nature. Just like when, like a person who is sleeping, here the example taken is, yatha suptasya iti artaha parikalpayanti, just as a person is sleeping in deep slumber, and when someone wakes him up, then what is he sleeping? He's sleeping in ignorance. He is not knowing anything. He is not knowing himself. He is not knowing the body. He is not knowing the world. Nothing he knows. In fact, he doesn't know himself because he's under the spell of ignorance in deep sleep. But when he's woken up, the moment he wakes up, whom does he wake up to when he wakes up? He wakes up to himself first. Then he becomes available to the mind and the thoughts and of the world, etc. See? In this manner, you understand. So now the word, where are we? So pratibodha viditam matam, and now the word amritatvam. Amritatvam hi vindate. That word is taken. That by knowing the self, by having the pratibodha, having come to know the self, how? Directly. then alone Amritatva is gained. Otherwise, it cannot be gained by second-hand methods. It cannot be gained through proxy. It cannot be gained through copying, copy-paste, someone else's sadhana. It cannot be gained through some reference, through some experience, through some contact, through some imagination, through some memory, through some expectation. No. Then how is Amritattvam gained? That is going to be talked about here. So the last point that we made was Atma or the self is a causeless entity. I can't even use the word entity. Is the causeless self. It is not caused by anything. The world is a ornament is the cause of the ornament is gold. The cause of the wave is water. The cause of the world, what I see, the colors and forms, the cause is the eyes. What is the cause of the senses? The mind. What is the cause of the mind? Intellect. What is the cause of the intellect? How can there be cause of anything that which does not exist in the first place? We can say it is the Chetana, it is the life principle. What is the cause of the life principle? We can say it is self if you want to say that way. But then because we have made this journey, what is the cause? What is the cause? What is the cause of the self? Now don't look for something. Don't say Ishvara is the cause of the self. Ishvara is not the cause of the self. Full stop. Self that we essentially are is causeless. It is not because nobody created it. Nobody carved it out. Nobody made it happen. It is self-existing, self-knowing, self-luminous, causeless. These are all pointers to the reality that our essential nature is. On one hand, we study the scriptures. On the other hand, we need to practice this. It will come after some time, I think. You will get there when it comes. Amritatvam amarana amarana bhavam Swatmani avasthanam moksham hi yasmad vindate labhate yathoktat pratibodhat pratibodha viditat pratibodha viditatmakat tasmat pratibodha viditameva mat matam iti abhiprayah. He is saying that if this knowledge is leading you to immortality, then whatever, meaning which knowledge, any knowledge, we are looking at arguments, we are looking at refuting those arguments of various philosophies, various standpoints. You are doing japa, you are doing kriya yoga, you are doing bhakti yoga, you are doing pranayama, you are doing whatever path you are following, it does not matter. If it is leading to pratibodha viditam matam, if it is leading to amritatvam, if it is leading to immortality, then it's okay. Then what path you follow, it does not matter. But truly speaking, It is a pathless path. There is no path going to immortality. We already said it is causeless. Otherwise, you will say, if we do this sadhana, then we will come to know the truth. Nope. It is not so. By self is not a result of any karma. Sadhana is karma only. You do sadhana at the body level, kaya, vacha, manasa. Then why are you doing kaya, vacha, manasa, sadhana? Why you are doing? Only to purify. You are not doing it to realize. You are not doing it to realize the truth that you are. You are only removing the dirt that has accumulated in your consciousness, in your mind, by various sadhanas. So correct this self-talk that if I do pranayama, I'll come to know the truth. If I come do the japa, I'll come to know the truth. No, it already, in Amrita Anubhava, it was told, Vaikari Madhyama Pashyanti Para, it is beyond these four, the truth. Then why are we practicing it? To purify, to overcome the inertia, to overcome the dynamism, to overcome the idea of purity. But you can transcend. There is a possibility of transcendence. These words will hit their mark if our mind is focused, if our mind is purified, and we are subjective in our approach. We are absolutely dissecting the basic requirement. What was the basic requirement according to Vivek Chudamani? Vivek, Vairagya, Shatka, Sampatti, and Mumukshutvam. This was the practice. Then after that, what do you need to do? Then you need to do Shravanam, Mananam, Nididhyasanam. So these two things, Vivek, Vairagya, Shatka, Sampatti, and Mumukshutvam, that has to be there on one side. And the other side, Shravanam, Mananam, Nididhyasanam. These two must go hand in hand. These two sets of sadhana. What will happen as a result? All the obstacles, all the anomalies. Because of those anomalies, the mind has come about. All the anomalies will get neutralized. They will become ineffective. And where they become ineffective, meaning, what is ineffectiveness? All this, what I'm saying in the last 2-3 minutes is not given in the book. In the Bhashya. What is ineffectiveness? Ineffectiveness means that in spite of all these anomalies available, we are not available to it. We are not available to it. We are available to ourselves. And therefore, we are not available to all those anomalies. That is the best way. So Amritatvam, here it says, Amritatvam, Amarana Bhavam, Swatmani, Avasthanam, Moksham, Hi Yasmad Vindate, Labhate, Yathoktat, Pratibodhat, Pratibodh viditatmakat, tasmat pratibodh viditam eva matam iti abhiprayaha. What he is saying is, amrutatvam is not an end result of the sadhana. The one who is a mumukshu, one who is a sannyasi, the one who is a seeker of the truth, what did we say when we began with Pratibodha Viditam Matam? When the scripture started explaining it, that with every thought, his attention, such this mumukshu's attention is not on the thought. His attention is not on that which is coming and going. Here you have to bring in the viveka. What is viveka? Discrimination between the permanent and the impermanent. So we are studying the scripture. We are getting the stimuli continuously. Here the stimuli is the speech that is taking place. It's going out. And in your case, it is being received. So these are the stimuli at this moment. See? So are we too focused on the words? Or is our attention on the constant principle that words are coming and going, understanding is happening, or confusion is taking place, or doubt is there, but I am the substratum. In my presence, these thoughts are coming and going. So with every thought, with every stimuli that is received by the mind, what does the mumukshu do? With every stimuli that is received by the mind in way of thought, he comes back, he has the pratibodha. He lands in the self as the self. His attention goes to the self. See, I will not take your name. Right now I can see Subramaniam. So because I can see Subramaniam, so the name Subramaniam is coming in my mouth. If I'm not talking, if he's not there, it's out of the... There needs to be a trigger for me to have a conversation with Subramaniam. Similarly, every thought that is erupting in the mind is a trigger for a mumukshu to have the knowledge of the self. Are we in that position at this moment? You are, but you have to recognize this. Everyone is.
Whether I'm here or not here, the person who is perceiving is always there. Is that the principle? The seer is always there. The constant principle is always there. Whether the stimulus is there or not.
Get the seer out of the way.
Okay.
We are not talking about the seer. Are you only the seer, or are you also the seer, hearer, toucher, feeler, thinker, taster? Everything put together you are, isn't it?
Absolute base of everything.
So are you just the husband, or are you the, you know, you have to take a different position. If you take the position of a husband, I know I'm a husband. So does that mean that you are not any other role that you are playing in life? If you say I'm a waker right now, so are you not also a dreamer and a sleeper? If you are a man right now, are you not a husband and a father or brother or a son to someone? When those stimuli come, then that will appear. Right now you are looking, so seer is appearing. But where is the seer appearing? This is what we are talking about. Seer will come and go. Hearer will come and go. Taster will come and go. Thinker will come and go. But do you come and go? You are the permanent one, isn't it? So stop becoming someone. Stop becoming the seer. Stop becoming the hearer, toucher, feeler, taster, thinker, knower, experiencer. Stop becoming. Just be. And this is the knack that you have to develop. You have to develop. The more we contemplate on this, Sharanam, Mananam, Nididhyasanam, it will click one day that you have this, the seer, hearer, toucher, feeler, thinker, all these erring subject, what we call as subject with respect to an object. So you are the seer with respect to seen. But that seer is only limited to the seen. The seer cannot be the hearer, isn't it? Because your attention is on the eyes, therefore you have taken your position as a seer. If your attention is on the ears, then you are taken the position of a hearer. Because you have seen your wife, so you are a husband. Because you have seen the mother, so you are a son. Because you are thinking of your children, therefore you are thinking of as a father. But are you these changing roles, or are you the man which is the constant one? From the man's point of view, it supports all the roles, but it is none of those roles. Similarly, here we are talking about that the mumukshu, how does he gain immortality? He doesn't gain immortality that one day I will gain immortality. One day with the last breath, I'll gain immortality. That when I finish my sadhana, then I'll gain immortality. That when I go to from Vaikari Madhyama Pashyanti Para, then I will gain immortality. But yaar, abhi bhi main Madhyama mein hi phasa hua hun. This is our lot. Because we don't practice Vivek Vairagya Shatka Sampatti and Mumukshutvam in its true sense. Then who is this mumukshu? Who is this wise seeker? With every stimuli, he is being the self. He is being the constant one. Every stimuli is an opportunity for him to be. It reminds him of himself. Can we bring ourselves to that position? That if you look at the wife, instead of becoming the husband, it reminds you of yourself. It brings you back to yourself. Acha, such a caricature, I supported to bring it into existence. Then the children. Acha, inko bhi. Mere bina ye bhi nahi ho sakta tha. Acha, the wars are going on. You are not thinking of the war, or you're not thinking of the wife, or you're not thinking of the children. But something or the other always keeps coming in the mind, isn't it? Not because you are thinking. If you say, no, I'm not thinking anything, but still some thoughts will come of their own volition. Don't become anyone at that moment. And Mumukshu, because he has practiced Vivek Vairagya Shatka Sampatti, he is able to straight away pratibodh viditam matam. He is able, and that's what, don't forget the context in which all this is going on. Third and fourth verse, and the fifth verse, these three verses are the explanation of what that student experienced in his meditation, because the teacher reprimanded him and corrected him. Acha, you know it very well. If you know it very well, you don't know. And then whatever the dialogue took place, and then he went and sat in the corner with that clarification. And then with that clarification, when he came to know, then he says, Naham manyesu vedeti no na vedeti vedacha, yo nastad veda tadveda no na vedeti vedacha. The second verse. And this experience that I know, but doesn't mean that I don't know. Yet I know, but I cannot say that I know. Like that he is going on. And that he is coming out of the true experience. True experience meaning direct experience. And this, his experience, his direct experience, that it is beyond the known and the unknown, because he's saying, I know, yet I don't know, but it's not that I don't know. That this truth is beyond the known and the unknown. Known and unknown is both at the relative level. But pratibodha, what he has come to know, the same thing, then the scripture, the Shruti Mata takes the verse and she is using in the third verse, it said, avignatam vijanatam. Yasya matam tasya matam matam yasya navedasaha avignatam vijanatam vignatam avijanatam. That it is beyond what he has come to know. What he is saying, in other words, is that he has come to know that he is beyond the known and the unknown. Then how has he? Because when you say, I am the seer knows the seen. You understand? But are we talking about that specific seer, or are we talking about that because of which all the seers, all the knowers, all the experiencers, all the knowers are born with respect to whatever their stimuli is? So seer is born with seen, hearer is born with heard, experiencer is born with experienced, waker is born with waking world, dreamer is born with dream world. Are we talking about this fellow, or are we talking about the one at this moment who knows that from childhood till now, so many wakers have come and gone, so many dreamers have come and gone. Every morning a new waker comes. Every day with every stimuli, a new seer is born, a new thought is born. So are we talking about that? That is not pratibodha viditam. Pratibodha viditam means not taking a specific position when a stimuli comes, because mind's job is to have a stimuli, a thought. And thought is always objective in nature. So the moment the thought comes, instead of becoming a seer or hearer or toucher or feeler or taster, remain without becoming anyone. That is pratibodha viditam matam. We are not talking about sakshi. Sakshi also means that this fellow, he is waiting and these are coming and going and he is, no. He is not becoming anything any. Finished, story over. It is not that you are going to create this reality. You are not going to create this self. You are already that. Remember the arguments that were given before, the Vaisheshikas, the Baudhas, and some the Nyayas, Nyayikas. That was given so that we are clear that Atma is not a concept of the intellect. Atma is not with reference to something. Atma does not come and go with every object. Then what is it? What is Atma? What is self? It's self-sustained. It is self-illumined. It is not, fourth one was, it is causeless. Atma is causeless. It is not caused by the coming of mind and an object. And those arguments, when we were saying, I was bringing us back to the constant principle again and again, while refuting those arguments. And if we have gone through those arguments or listened to it again, when you have free time, so who is a mumukshu? You can argue this way, that way, whichever way. Here he is saying that this mumukshu, that with every pratyaya, with every stimuli, he is having atmagyan with every stimuli. And stimuli necessarily appears as a thought. With every thought, he is having atmagyan, pratibodh. Pratibodh means atmagyan. Not because of the stimuli he is having, but instead of becoming the knower of the thought, or liker of the thought, or disliker of the thought, or whatever position you want to take. Now understand, you cannot live in the self as the self without thoughts. Thoughts will always be there. As long as you are living, as long as you have a body, as long as you are alive, you have a mind, and that mind's job is to have thoughts. Are you disturbed because your eyes are illuminating so many things in the world? Are you disturbed because are the ears disturbed because they are hearing so many words? No, ears are not disturbed. They are neutral. Let good sounds come, bad sounds come. Ego is disturbed. Ear is not disturbed. So also every sense. Is the mind disturbed because so many thoughts are erupting within the mind? No, ego is disturbed. The jiva is disturbed. But the mind is not disturbed. If it was disturbed, then it would not allow the appearance and disappearance of the thoughts. The nature of the mind is to allow the thoughts to appear and then go away. The nature of the eyes is to illuminate colors and forms. And it keeps changing. Every moment it keeps changing. The nature of the ears is to illuminate the sound. So the senses are not disturbed by what they are illuminating. Mind is not disturbed by what it is illuminating. Then who gets disturbed? The individual. How does he get disturbed? Because he owns it. I am hearing, so I become the hearer. I am seeing, so I become the seer. I am knowing, so I become the knower. I am experiencing, I become the experiencer. This fellow, he gets disturbed. And who is this mumukshu? He is the one who does not get disturbed. Okay, let the mind do its job. Let the senses do its job. Why should I interfere? I am the constant. If the mind feels like it wants to be empty, it will be empty for some time, which will be called, and if you are awake, it will be called Nirvikalpa Samadhi. See? So have we developed that acumen, that knack by which every thought is leading to self-knowledge, pratibodh. Such is a wise man. Therefore, pratibodh is the knowledge of our own essential self. This has to be recognized. It is not because of the thought, it is not because of the waker, it is not because of the dreamer, it is not because of the presence or absence. No. This essential self is self-existing. In its presence, things come and go. Let them come and go. And this, and it is of the Swatmani Avasthanam Moksham. So another way you can say that this essential self is of the nature of independence. It is not dependent on anything, any stimuli, any thought, any experience. It is not dependent on anything. And that is our true nature. That is our true nature. That is who we are essentially. We are only making believe. If I take myself to be a speaker right now, if you take yourself to be the listener, you are making believe. Essentially, you are the independent principle, self-existing, self-knowing, constant, undisturbed. But the moment you identify with something, that very moment we become someone. So this was the abhipraya. This was what was. Then it says, bodhasya hi pratyagatma vishayatvam cha matam amritatve hetuhu nahi atmano atmanaha anatmatvam amritatvam bhavati. He says, that knowledge of the self as the self. And what is this knowledge of the self as the self? Knowledge of the self as the self without a thought alone is immortality. Alone is immortality. See, absence of the self here, nahi atmano atmanatvam amritatvam bhavati. Absence of the self cannot be the cause of the self. Absence cannot be. What is this Atma? Atma is that. This essential self is that. Which is in spite of absence and presence. What is sun? Sun is transcendental to day and night. What is day? Presence of light. What is night? Absence of light. What is Atma? Atma is that which is transcendental to presence of thoughts, stimuli, absence of theirs. See? Because there is nothing, so Atma, no, Atma is self-existing. It's not because we said, oh, we have to remove all the stimuli, we have to dissolve the I. All those were certain techniques. But Pratibodha is not, it's a technique-less technique. And therefore, here he says, Atmatvad Atmanaha Amritatvam Nirnimittam Eva. He says that the nature of the Atma itself is that of immortality. The nature of the self is of immortality. And therefore, immortality is not caused by knowing the reality. No, the self is reality and its nature is immortality. This thing, this idea must get out of our head that one day we will attain the self. Instead of this thought takes predominant place in our mind only because we think this world is real and we think that we are a part of this world by being this body, by being having thought about it and celebrated many times that I was born one day, that I'm growing. And just like everything in this life is achieved through hard work, we think Atma is also to be achieved through hard work. No, dear. Atma is not a result of achievement, is not a result of efforts. Na karmana na prajayadhane na tyage naike amrutatvamanashuhu. Immortality is gained neither by karma, neither by progeny, neither by wealth. Then tyage naike amritatvamanashuhu. By giving up. Giving up means what? When you have given up everything, what is left? Absence. When you give up the absence, as our Swamiji says, in the absence, you give up the absence, you reach the reality, reach the self. You reveal yourself to yourself once you give up the absence. Meaning, we have this bad habit of, this is a phone, now there is no phone here. There is no phone does not mean there is something there. Because we are extrovert in our approach, so we know there is presence of phone, now there is absence, but is absence an object of cognition? This we have to very coolly sit down and contemplate on this. Is absence an object of contemplation? Some people say, oh, I saw a void and I got afraid. What are you afraid? There's not, is an void. Void means nothingness. Nothingness means no thing. Is, therefore, is nothing emptiness or nothingness or absence, is it an object to be perceived? It's not an object, it has got no contours. So instead of focusing on this problem remains as long as we are objective in our approach. If we are subjective in our approach, then the moment all the objects are removed, immediately we will land. This is from a seeker's point of view. When objects are removed, we come to ourselves. What happens? Samadhi. But we here in Pratibodha Viditam, we are not talking about samadhi. We are talking about immortality. We are talking about coming to our essential nature, which is always. It is not created. It is not created by removing the thoughts from the mind. Instead, what this student has done, this seeker has done, because the mind is there, how long will it take to stop? I don't know. So is there any other way that I can, at this, if the truth is the self is every moment and I can't stop the thoughts, then how do I come to know the self right now? Take the thought as the pole vault and jump into Atmagnan. The wave is already the water. The mind is already the pure consciousness that I am. See? Therefore, that this self is not created. It is not caused because of anything. It is causeless. This whole argument was that it was causeless knowledge. Meaning, it is that knowledge which is free of thoughts. I have to come to know the I without the thought that I am that. How long will I as a thought remain? How long will camphor burn? How long will the flame in the camphor remain? As long as the material called camphor is not totally consumed by the fire. And once the camphor is completely consumed by the fire, which is slowly but surely eating it away and converting it and glowing as fire, when the material is finished, then what happens? The fire also goes away. Same way, how long will, this is not given here, I'm bringing it in. How long will the aham vritti, who am I, how long will who am I continue if we are focused on the I am, I am, I am, I am, soham, 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 soham. How long? Aham Brahmasmi, Aham Brahmasmi, Om, Om, whatever way. As long as there is some fuel to be consumed, as long as there are doubts, as long as there are suspicions, as long as there is extrovertedness, till then we have to keep thinking of the I, who am I? But once everything, all objectivity is consumed by the focus on the aham vritti, I thought, then I thought has got no fuel anymore in order to remain. It also dies away. What dies away? The thought aspect of the I dies away. I continues. I without a thought, vritti rahit aham, continues. Because it was always that vritti rahit aham, that pure consciousness, that Atman is of the nature of immortality. Immortality is not a result of something. Hope it's clear. Evam martyatvam atmanaha yad vidyaya anatma pratipattihi anatmatva pratipattihi. So here it says death, martyatvam, death is also avidya, is also out of ignorance, and therefore because in Atma there is nothing called a death. Atma is of the nature of immortality, and if we are considering ourselves that we are going to die one day, it's only because we have accepted
us as a body,
ourselves as the body, which we are not. In look at our foolishness. In dream, every night we have a new body. We don't complain. And we want to hold on to the same body. What? How boring it is in the waking. Same body every day. This is one angle of approach. Second angle, you are unaware that every day body is changing, but you are thinking it is the same one. You have superimposed your constancy, your permanence on the body, your continuity as Atma. Because of your ignorance of the self, you have taken that the body is continuous. The same body was yesterday, same body is today, same body will continue tomorrow when I wake up. But actually, it is not the body which is continuous, it is the Atma which is continuous. And this foolish approach, this foolish conviction, this foolish idea, we are continuously living with and committing sabotage within ourselves as regards pratibodha. Don't do this to yourself. That's why you are listening. That's why I'm speaking. That's why you are interacting with this Upanishad, that may our bearings become right. We are not here to stop the world from going on. We are not here to not allow the body to grow young or old. We are not here to stop the senses. We are not here to stop the mind. But we are here only for one. We want to be the constant one in spite of all this. We want to be the unchanging one. And we are that at this very moment we are. But if someone is dying, today only I got a news, one of my classmates or went to the hospital, had a cardiac arrest and died. And immediately all the other friends in the school group, oh, our day is also coming, and this and that. If someone's death reminds of our impending death, then we have not understood spirituality at all. We are avinashi. Our nature is avinashi, indestructible self. And body also does not die. It only unmanifests and becomes one with the five elements, only to come again together and come in another form somewhere. Okay. Oh, but if we are, so here, if we are thinking about death, then we are thinking about not self. Not self is the Jivatma. Remember, what is Vivek? Atma, Anatma. So if we are thinking about death, then we are thinking about Anatma, not about Atma. Katham punaha yathoktaya atma vidyaya amrutatvam vindata ityata aha. Atmana svena rupena vindate labhate viryam balam samarthyam. So now question is asked. What is the question? That how amrutatvam is gained by discovering our essential nature. I have already said it in different ways, but let's see what he says here. How amrutatvam is gained to discover our essential nature? So answer is told. Atmana svena rupena vindate labhate viryam balam samarthyam. This is the second part of the fourth verse. What is that? Let me read it. Atmana vindate viryam vidyaya vindate amrutam. Second line. Atmana svena rupena vindate labhate viryam balam samardhyam. So how does he gain the essential nature? If he cannot, realizing the self is not caused by any sadhana, it is a causeless, it is consciousness is not created by a mind and object coming together. Consciousness is not because I think, therefore I am, therefore it is not the Atma. Then how do we come to know the self then? Have you ever thought about it? How do we know the self? Can anyone say anything? Any wise words? How do we come to know this immortal self?
Because we are constant through all the happenings. We are present or witnessing everything that's happening without the witness itself changing. We are the constant principle.
Okay. Anyone else?
We cannot come to know, Swamiji, but by being.
Good. Okay. Anyone else? Who realized beings? Contribute.
We can't know the self, Swamiji, anyway.
ठीक है आपका हो गया अभी अभी और किसी को
अभी ट्यूबलाइट लग रहा है थोड़ा थोड़ा नोइंग सेल्फ बताने से गड़बड़ है
आपने बोल दिया रेणुका सेड वी नीड वन मोर कम ऑन एवरीवन वांट्स टू बी अ लिसनर नोबडी वांट्स टू आंसर आर यू ऑल अफ्रेड ऑफ बीइंग रॉन्ग The truth is not for the faint-hearted. It is for the courageous one. So, question was how Amritatva or immortality is gained by discovering our essential nature. How it is gained? It cannot be gained by anything else. It is gained by itself. Because what is the nature of the self? Self-knowing. Can you know the self by knowing something else? No. Can you know the self by through the thoughts? No. Can you know the self through some feeling? No. Can you know the self through concepts? No. Can you know the self through some reference? No. Can you take any support of Kriya or Kundalini or Japa or whatever to come to know the self? No. Then how can you come to know the self? Only self knows the self. So now this becomes a pointer for us, not in Shravana or Manana, when we are doing Nididhyasana, that are we constantly thinking about the self or are we being the self? In spite of the thoughts, that only you can come to know. So, here it says, what is that? Atmana svena rupena vindate labhate viryam balam samarthyam. The strength and ability to walk this path is not from anything outside. Uddharet atmana atmanam natmanam avasadayet. Raise yourself by yourself. In yourself. So raise the self by the self. It does not say raise the self by Kriya Yoga. It did not say raise the self by Bhakti Yoga. It did not say raise the self by Kundalini Yoga. It did not say raise the self by studying the Upanishads. It did not say raise the self by Raj Yoga or Bhagavad Gita or whatever. What did it say? Raise the self by the self. Know the self by the self. आत्मा ही आत्मा को जानती है न यतो वाचो निवर्तन्ते अप्राप्य मनसा सह. All the words that we are using at this moment, यतो वाचो निवर्तन्ते, these words, I am using the words आत्मा knows आत्मा, but these are only words, they are limited. What they are indicating, you are, I am. So these words, are we getting inspired by these words? Then we have put our inspiration in the pocket of Upanishads. We have put our realization in the hands of the Upanishads. Should we not study then? Of course you must study. But Upanishad itself is saying that you have to go beyond the words. Yato vacho nivartante taitre upanishad. So only atma knows atma. Pratibodha is knowing the self by the self. Then the true strength, then the atma bala comes about. Then the vitality, the inspiration, the courage that comes, it does not come because I have gained that strength from outside. Because I'm doing pranayam, so now my body has become disease-proof. Because I have controlled my pranas, now I don't feel hungry or thirsty. You stop doing pranayam, you will become hungry and thirsty. Because I have focused my mind on something, on the name of the Lord, therefore my mind is not swayed by raga dvesh. You stop doing japa, it will be swayed by raga dvesh. See? So if I'm thinking of the self, then I am the self. But when I stop thinking of the self, then what will happen? Then you are not the self. Dekho. So don't think in this manner. And what is this outside wealth? The outside wealth, dhana sahaya mantra ushadhi tapo yoga krutam viryam mrityum na shaknoti abhibhavitum anitya vastu krutatvat. Dhan, help, mantra, aushadhi, that is medicine, tapa, yoga, and by practicing all this, the vitality that is gained, it is gained through anitya vastu. Dhan is anitya, friends, help, support is anitya, mantra is anitya, medicine, aushadhi, herbs, they are anitya. Tapa is anitya. As long as you are doing it, it gives its result. Once you stop, it goes away. It doesn't give you the same result permanently. And also, yoga is anitya. Because where can yoga take you? It can go take you only up to nirvikalpa samadhi. After that, what? The moment samadhi breaks, again the world is there. So we are not talking about the vitality. We are not talking about the virya. We are not talking about the bala, which is gained through anitya vastu. And these are all anitya. I am not saying it. Upanishad is saying it. Shruti Mata herself is saying it. That all the practices are anitya practices. So whether it is karma, bhakti, japa, kriya, yoga, rajyoga, ashtanga yoga, even for that matter, discrimination is also, you're thinking again and again, what is the difference between nitya and anitya? It is only at the intellectual level when you begin. So, all that bala, strength, vitality, that which is gained through these anitya practices, that means when our attention is outside, by doing something, by interacting with something, taking support of something, when we do the practices, yes, they give you certain results. They'll give you certain experiences. They'll give you certain strength, but it is not eternal. That vitality that you have gained, it is gained through some support. When that support is taken away, the vitality, inspiration, courage also goes away. Then what are we talking about? Here it says, Atma vidya kritam tu virya atmana eva vindate. Na anyena iti ata ananya sadhanatvad atma vidya viryasya tadeva viryam mrityum shaknoti abhibhavitum. How beautifully our Shankaracharya ji is saying that when our attention is on outside and we gain vitality, inspiration, conviction. Conviction is also virya, because once you are convinced, your conviction is not shaken. But if that conviction is because of something, then it is caused, no? And therefore, this type of conviction, this type of virya, this type of bala, this type of strength, it cannot conquer death. Nirvikalpa samadhi is not equal to conquering death. It's not immortality. Open your eyes, come out of the meditation, world is still there. Because all these practices, all these supports, all the wealth, all the yoga, all the mantra, eventually it reduces, it decays, interest goes away. You have to continuously pump in the energy to maintain it. You have to convince yourself why it is important for you to keep doing this. And if there are no experiences, if there are no symptoms of growth, there you go, poof, like the air out of the balloon. Someone has punctured you. So because they are not eternal in nature, all these practices, then how can they take us beyond death? Because they themselves are anitya. Question to be put in front of ourselves. So Upanishad has done that for us. So how can it make us immortal? Therefore, the real strength is Atma Bala. Atma Bala means that strength and vitality which comes from the Atma itself. We do not add heat and light to the sun. The power of heat and light is the nature of the sun, isn't it? Same way, when the strength is gained, fearlessness is gained, vitality and strength is gained, when it expresses as a result of being the self, that strength, that vitality never decays. Once realized, once immortal, ever immortal. Once immortal, ever immortal. It's not like, oh, am I a man or am I a woman? I'm confused. So, start taking tablets to become the other. No. This is only, am I realized or am I not realized? This question will remain only when we are pursuing it with some support, when our attention is on objects. We are doing some sadhana. Till we are doing some sadhana, this doubt will always remain. But when we are doing Shravana, Shravana is not sadhana. In its truest sense, if you are listening actively, available, without preformed notions, without comparisons, completely empty, and allowing every word that is coming towards you to hit its mark, because your attention is not on the word. Your attention is on the totality. Your attention is on the infinity. Not even totality, the infinity. Ishavasyam idam sarvam. Then every word, as we said, pratibodh, what was the meaning of pratibodh, viditam matam? Every thought, every object, the moment it comes, because that's the nature of the mind, we are with the self. Instead of being with the object, we are with the self. when there is an absence of the object, we are still with the self. So in the absence also we are with the self. But do you know that when between the two thoughts where there is absence of thought, you are with yourself as the Atman. But have you recognized that? Or looking forward to what the next sentence is going to be? What the next pointer is going to be? So that we can say that, yes, I understood. See?
Is it similar to the state that we are waking up and not fully awake?
Yes, yes, yes. Yes. That is the place to catch it. How can you, if we don't have faith in our own self, how can we have faith in another person? How can we have faith in another support? How can we have faith in some other path? How can we have faith in some object which is not permanent when we don't even have faith in ourselves? Question to be asked. Atmabala. See, they say, some people say, oh, learn from other people's mistakes. Some people say, no, I believe, I do that, but if certain experiences happen, I learn through them, it is my learning, and I don't have to remember that what I learned from others. Why? Because it is my experience, it is always there with me. Same way, when we are studying the Upanishads, don't take it as a information download. Interact with it, atmatvena. Allow the ears to hear, allow the thoughts to come in the mind, but you remain as the self. Be the self. Don't become the listener. Don't become the listener. Your attention should be on yourself, in whose presence the thoughts are also coming and the absence of thought is also is being illumined or is happening. And you are present in both. Where the thought is there also, you are present. Not intellectually, by being. And when there is absence of thought, then also you are there. That is pratibodha. This was the first step. But when we say because of the thought, because of the object, then we are taking support. So that was the first step. Here, how is immortality gained? Immortality is gained only by having faith in the self as the self. It cannot be outsourced to something, to any sadhana, to any thought, to any conviction, to any idea, to any concept, to any seeking, to any teacher, to any book. Nope. Self is self-revealing. Self is self-knowing, pratibodha, bodha. Bodh means knowing, self-knowing. Self-knowledge is uncaused. It does not require a thought. Now do experiment with yourself or let that experiment happen while you are listening. So in this manner, na anyena iti yataha ananya sadhanatvad atma vidhi viryasya tadeva viryam mrityu shaknoti abhibhavitum. We saw this. Now, yat evam atma vidyakrutam viryam atmanaiva vindate ataha vidyaya atma vishayaya vindate amrutam amrutatvam. Nayam atma balahinena labhyaha mundakopanishad ityadharvane ataha samartho hetuhu amrutatvam hi vindata iti. So here he says, the true understanding, here it says, the evam atma vidyakrutam, the knowledge, the vidya of the atma can be gained only through atma. It cannot be gained through thoughts. You understand what we are saying, what the Upanishad is saying? And that is true vitality. That is true strength. That is atma bala. Ataha vidyaya atma vishayaya vindate amrutam amrutatvam. Therefore, only by topics that relate to atma, with that only atma can be amrutatva can be gained. And the Mundaka Upanishad says that nayam atma balahinena labhyaha, that a person who is balahin, without any vitality, without any strength, without any strength, it is not available to such a person. In other words, a person who is objective in his pursuit of the atma will never come to know atma. There will always be an element of suspicion, doubt, fear in that person if he is objective in his pursuit. And don't collect this as an information. Right now you assess yourself. Are you objective in pursuit or are you subjective? If you are subjective, we will be slowly our it should happen in one go, one click. Just like you switch it on, the light comes on. It doesn't come on slowly. There's no dimmer there. In atma also no dimmer. When we are subjective, we are fearless. Story full stop. And therefore, if one immortality means going beyond death, and going beyond death is only possible when we know the self as the self. And how will we come to know the self as the self? Only the self can reveal itself. And therefore, what we have to do? Be subjective. Accept. Be. And that is the way to immortality. With this, the fourth verse is over, and now we'll look at the fifth verse in our next class. And the topic of that is, the essence is Atmagyan alone. So, and what is it? We'll see it in our next class. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnaat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. हरि ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरि ओम। Sit quietly for a minute.